Thanks, Lydia, and good morning, everybody. It's actually good to be here again at Akademy, giving a talk this time. That's actually fun, and I'm not getting it up on the screen. Before when I tried it? Oh, they replugged the thing. No idea what. Guys, what did you do? Okay, I'll let somebody else fix that and start just talking a little bit. It's actually a pleasure to be here. As some of you might know, actually, I started working on Qt and things in KDE a bit more than 20 years ago. That was a long time. It was something that I did there during my studies, as maybe many of you did when they got started. And I got fascinated with the technology. I really started loving Qt, and I had the great opportunity to be offered a job there at that time, Trolltech in Norway. Went there, started working on the technology. Still doing KDE works in the early years, lots of work on KHTML, but focused then more and more on Qt. Also I'm doing today, I think there's a signal going out, by the way. Otherwise, the screen would probably look different on my side. But
the screen is theoretically connected to here, so we don't know where it's going wrong.
Okay.
It's in line there.
Well, I'll let you to that. Somewhat difficulties. In any case, so I thought I'll talk a little bit about Qt 6 today. And it's actually great to be here. And Qt and KDE, we've always had a pretty close relationship. Qt as a technology would probably not exist today anymore without the help or the visibility that it got from KDE, especially in the early years. At the same time, KDE is built on top of Qt as the technology, as one of the main frameworks, and where you all do build software on top of that. As has become a little bit of a thing, you know, every once in a while, we try to move to a next merger version of Qt. It's been 6-7 years now since we moved to Qt 5, and we're seeing now that, hey, fantastic. Thank you so much. So it's been 7 years since we moved to Qt 5, and we've seen that a lot of things have changed in the world around us. We've gathered a lot of ideas and things that we wanted to change in Qt and fix in Qt, and so I thought, and many other thoughts, it's about time that we move to the next major version of Qt. And traditionally, as I also know from KDE's side, this has always been a point where also KDE sat down then and rethought a couple of things and usually also moved to the next version of KDE. Maybe a year or two later, but it usually happened with that. So let's see what happens this time. I'm going to present you a little bit the plans that we have for Qt 6, some of the ideas we're having. I have a lot of content, so let's go through that, maybe have most questions at the end. I'm also here for today and tomorrow, so if you have any more questions afterwards, grab me and I'll hope we can go through some of those things. Let's get started. I talked a little bit about that already, the motivation. We released Qt 5 in 2012. Was done somewhat in a haste after we got out of Nokia at that time. That's, I don't know, all of you might not know the history, but Qt was owned by Nokia, was used for their frameworks, and at some point Nokia moved over to Windows Phone and then decided to sell off Qt again. And everybody thought Qt was sort of a dead technology, and we were trying to show people that it's still alive and we're really doing good stuff there. We used the early Qt 5 years to prove that Qt was a viable technology, expand to the mobile and embedded ecosystems, and largely expand our functionality as well. It was a lot of stuff we did at that time. But now, after 7 years, I believe it's time to adapt to some of the things that have changed in the world around us. Clean up and re-architecture our core. As I said, we've been doing focusing a lot on expanding the scope of Qt in the early years. Let's get back to the center and the core of Qt and see what we want to do and do there and what we can change and improve there. and prepare for what we see coming in the next years. Give you an idea of what we're currently thinking of as a roadmap. We have released 5.13 in May, currently working towards 5.14. We've gone and done feature freeze and the branching for 5.14 just 2 weeks ago, and we'll work on that one. Then we will have one more release, Qt 5.15, next year in May, probably with not a smaller feature delta from 5.14 to 5.15 than usually, even though there's still quite a few good things coming, and I'll talk about one or two also here in this talk. And then November next year, tentatively, Qt 6. Let's see how the schedule will change, but I hope that we can somewhat keep that schedule. To do that, we've also started now moving most the development branch of Qt over to be Qt 6. And that's work that's currently just happening. Hope we'll be done with that in a week or two. But before we go and look into some of the features and things, what's actually core and central to Qt? What are the things that we need to take care of when we move to a next major version? The core values, what makes Qt valuable for our users and our customers, are actually a couple of things. One of them is cross-platform capabilities. It exists on all desktop operating systems, on the mobile operating systems, and we have a large coverage in the embedded space as well. Scalability. You can do very small things with Qt. People do huge projects. If you look out there on the desktop space, things like Autodesk Maya, KDE, of course, air traffic control systems in Europe and Germany, and other stuff. We're trying to have really good APIs, great tools, and documentation focus on that. I forgot the ease of use. That's really, really important. C++ as an API tends to be complex. We want to make it easy to use and have a good and intuitive API around all of the things we're doing. Make it fun to work also with Qt. Should be the code you're writing using Qt should be easily maintainable. We should have stability in our APIs and compatibility. And of course, we have a large developer ecosystem. Looking at our download numbers, we estimate that there are around 1 million developers out there worldwide, maybe a bit more than that, using Qt regularly. So a new version of Qt needs to adjust the product to whatever we think we need in the future, while keeping those six things at the heart of what we're doing. Keep that always in mind with all the things we're doing. For Qt 6, one of the things that we have realized that is the growth in usage for Qt will mostly come from the embedded sector, from embedded device. That's where we see a lot of companies now out there moving to using embedded Linux, for example, or some other operating systems like QNX, but they all want to attach a touchscreen now to the embedded device. We need to be able to scale down to rather low-end hardware because the price point in many of those devices is very crucial, but also scale up to high-end projects. Desktop and mobile, of course, have a lot of the developer mind share, and a great support there is a prerequisite for us and Qt to be able to also grow into the embedded space and support all of that. One of the goals that I see is that we want to have a more integrated workflow for everybody that includes not only the people that write code, but also other people that are associated with creating applications or embedded devices, UX designers, QA engineers, maybe even technical writers. See how can we integrate those better into the workflow. And we've started a lot of work there, especially on the UX design thing, because that was where we saw the biggest problem so far. And of course, how can we strengthen the ecosystem around Qt, capture new developers, provide a good infrastructure so that people can see that. And I'll come back to that a little bit at the end of the talk. It's not directly related to Qt 6.0, but still something to keep in mind. But then there's a couple of things that we want to do really for this first version of Qt 6, because that is the one place where we can break binary compatibility with Qt 5, and to some extent we're also okay with breaking some level of source compatibility, so that certain things that worked in Qt 5 will not compile in Qt 6 anymore. And use that the opportunity there to prepare Qt for what's coming in 2020 and beyond. A lot of cleanups in our code base to keep things maintainable for ourselves and hopefully be able to move faster and do all the architectural changes we couldn't do without breaking one of the two things above. So that's really the goal for Qt 6. It's not about maximizing the amount of new features that we're doing. It's about changing internals in Qt and preparing for what us afterwards being able to do lots of new things. Doesn't mean we will not have lots of cool new things in Qt 6.0, but the main goal has to be on that those re-architecture things. So here's a couple of focus areas. I'll go through those afterwards, and so just so you see, there's a couple of things: compatibility, cleaning ups, build system, API, graphics. There's a lot of things around QML. I'll actually talk quite a bit there, and the tooling side of things. Compatibility with Qt 5 is important. You have a large code base in KDE based on Qt 5, and some of you have been going through the exercises of porting, you know, from one Qt version to another, from Qt 2 to Qt 3 to Qt 4 to Qt 5. And you know, some of those efforts have been more painful than others. Especially, I would say 3 to 4 has been rather painful. With 5 to 6, hopefully we can do it in a way that it's not too painful for you. I want to keep the porting effort minimal as we can. So we break the binary compatibility, so you don't need to recompile, but that's not a big deal. And limit the source incompatible changes as much as we can, even though there will be some things that we will probably say, okay, it's worth breaking this, because you know the gain is much bigger than the cost. But limit those, because each change that breaks source compatibility will require effort from you to port over and from all our users. Avoid behavioral changes, because those are really, really hard to find unless we can detect things at compile time. My goal is that we can have applications compiling against both the last version of Qt 5, 5.15, and 6.0 with, let's say, minimal workarounds. Let's see how close we get to that goal, but we should have that as a goal in mind. Nevertheless, we'll do some house cleaning and we'll remove all functionality that has been deprecated in the lifetime of Qt 5. I don't know if KDE has turned on deprecation warnings. I hope so, because then it's easy. If not, it's a bit more work. That's a problem, but yes. So we'll remove all of that functions. For all modules, some classes, and you know, individual methods inside classes. Modules that will get removed, just so you know already: Qt Script, really old JavaScript engine, Qt Canvas 3D, Qt Quick Controls 1, Qt Quick 1. I don't know, I hope you're not really using a whole lot of that anymore, but let's see. Some classes will probably get removed might end up to live in a Qt 5 compat module. I'm not sure about that one yet. It depends on how much they're going to be used. But QRegExp and QList could be examples of that. I'll come back to QList a little later and tell you about the plan there. But RegExp, we have QRegular expression. I really want to remove the amount of JavaScript engines, regular expression engines we have in Qt, because currently we have 3 of them. And feels like too much. So let's get at least rid of one of them. Good. Another thing we're doing and changing is the build system that we're using to build Qt. I thought, you know, at least here in this audience, this would be uncontroversial. Great. It's not quite as uncontroversial as some other places, but I think it's the right choice. We've had QMake for a long time. It was done during Q2 years. We will still support users using QMake in Q6, so this is not going away. We will have to support QMake. The amount of users out there are just too big. But we encourage now new people to start their projects using CMake as the build system. And that's what we're going to use for Qt6 ourselves as well. There's a good effort ongoing. We have had a couple of workshops there, part of them in the KDub offices in Berlin. We're making very good progress, I think, and I hope that we can merge that into the development branch within the next month or two, hopefully. So that's, I hope, good news. Another thing we're going to change is that we're upgrading the C++ version that we require to you for Qt6. Move over all the way to C++17. Can't move to 20 yet because the compilers don't fully support it. Especially, there's lots of problems with Apple Clang and Microsoft compilers. But we want to use C++ 17 to build Qt as a minimum requirement, and we want to see also how we can integrate better with some of those standard APIs. That's a balance we need to strike here, because the standard APIs have somewhat different goals than Qt. Their goal is really to make them allow for most efficient implementations. Don't pay for what you don't use. Qt, the goal is slightly different. I want to have APIs that are easy to use and easy to maintain. So for me, it's more important that it's easy for developers to get to their goal implementing things, and maybe, if you pay a few extra cycles there, it's probably okay. So intuitive and simple APIs, something really important for us, and we want to continue doing that. Make C++ easy and accessible. Some of those standard APIs can get very intimidating for people coming to C++ from other programming languages. If it's template heavy, all of us, I know, struggle still from time to time, and you go back after a couple of weeks and reread your code that you've written, and takes you a little time to understand again what you've been doing there. At least that's for me. So I want to make sure that the APIs in Qt stay easy and accessible. And it's fine because 90% of the user's code is usually not performance critical. So some extra cycles for simple APIs, so to make keep APIs simple, is probably acceptable, but of course not acceptable if things go from a linear algorithm to a quadratic algorithm or something like that, or log n to quadratic. So ideally, we want to have both simple APIs, great performance. Let's see how we can do that. We've been good at that in the past. When we now want to work closer with C++ 17, there's certainly some places where we need to find out where the compromise is between those two things. Unicode throughout, that was a goal I had already put out for Qt 5, and we didn't manage to pull it through completely. Reason was that there were a couple of Microsoft compilers didn't really allow us to do that because I wanted to basically say, okay, let's by default interpret all source code as being UTF-8. Clang and GCC already do that by default, so that's good. All text handling assumes Unicode. All conversions from basically a literal string in source code to QString assume UTF-8. We want to move all the codec-related things for different text encodings, Latin 1, Shift JIS, whatever, out of Qt Core. Separate library if you need it, but let's not have that integrated in Qt Core anymore. One thing that came up lately, and that's been a little bit more in the thinking, and this is still early thinking for me, but I would like to simplify our string handling. It's got too complex. I remember, in 2002, 2003, I was at Akademy there, and we've been looking at Mozilla source code at that point, and we started making fun of it because they had 20 different string classes, yeah. Or seven, something like that. I think it was more seven. And let me see, Q string literal, q Latin one string, const car stars, q string ref, q string view. Did I miss something? At least that's six. I think I missed something. Byte array with a Latin one encoding. We're getting just as messy. It's getting too complex. We need to simplify that. I still don't quite know how to do it, but I have some ideas. I would like to have something where string literals can just be written in quotes, whether you use a U prefix or not in C++ 17. I don't think that should matter. Q string view, make byte array probably ASCII only, and hopefully we can deprecate all the other ones. And then the question is still for me also a little bit, can QString actually support both UTF-8 and UTF-16 behind the scenes? There's a couple of methods that expose the internals. It makes it a bit tricky. Let's see something to think about. At least I want to think about what can be done there. Want to rethink our containers a little bit? Unify QList and QVector. QList has been this little bit complex class, with different behaviors depending on different types and different attributes or type info, how you declare type info. Basically, if QList becomes an alias to vector, QVector, that's almost 100% source compatible. It simplifies our API because we have one less container class to worry about, and it improves the performance in pretty much 90% of the cases. So we're good with that. I want to do that, and I have the patches there. We just need to work out a few final details. Question is, can we base QMap, QSet, QHash, our associate GIF containers on the standard APIs for better interoperability and actually to reduce our own maintenance load on those classes? But it said it's important that we keep an easy-to-use API there. So something to think about in the core of Qt. There's other things that items that we're going through, but can't probably mention everything here. And I'm running late anyway already, so have to see. A big topic for me is also looking at QML and the next generation QML. What can we do there? QML was, we released that as a first version in Qt 4.8 and then kept the language pretty much unchanged for Qt 5, even though at Qt Quick, the UI elements changed quite a bit. QML currently has some issues. We require a full JavaScript engine and a garbage collector, which is not very suited for low-end devices and hardware, and can lead to some unpredictable performance characteristics due to the GC. The object model is built on top of the Qt object model, so meaning it duplicates a lot of data structures at runtime. We have lots of mallocs and a large initialization overhead. Things like binding propagations in QML, they're immediate, and they're not really synced with the scene graph, and we're duplicating a lot of binding evaluations there often. And we have a weakly typed language, which has its own share of problems because we can't easily generate the most efficient code at compile time. We can only do that at runtime using a JIT, which is not ideal. And it also has problems in terms of refactoring code. We have a language problem. Some of the scoping rules in QML are difficult to understand. What's in scope and where? The integration with C++ is not quite ideal. Sometimes you've been probably doing that. It's doable, but I wish it was simpler. And the QML versioning has been a thorn in my eye ever since we had it. Because C++ doesn't need that, right? We do minor version upgrades in C++ without having to do any versioning of that stuff. Can't we do that in QML? And I think we can with a slight change to the language. And it would make our life easier to maintain Qt, and it would make the user's life easier maintaining their code. We don't have private properties, and as said, the weakly typed, being weakly typed means that we can't catch things at compile time, coding errors, which I think is problematic. And we can't really see also all the types in the code models. So we're changing a lot of things for Qt 6. I want to introduce strong typing there, make that available, at least optional. JavaScript should be optional as a feature in QML. Get rid of the versioning, get rid of the duplicated data structures, don't generate a lot of data structures at runtime, even if we can avoid it, if we can do them at compile time. Support compiling QML to efficient C++ native code. We've had a QML compiler that compiled in, you know, as a commercial thing a couple of versions back that compiled QML to C++, but it wasn't efficient, it was still generic code. Hiding implementation details and better tooling. Let's see what we're doing there. First thing is improving the type system. We want to generate better type information at compile time. Requires some changes to QMeta type and how we register that data. Add certain features and certain data to the meta object system that we require in QML, so that we can also, you know, put that into the meta object and metadata at compile time, and make sure that we can look up that data fast enough. Because currently, those meta type lookups are not really efficient. They're not made to be as fast as possible. And with that, I think we can get rid of the QML property cache runtime data structures. We're also looking, and that's going to be an exciting thing on the C++ side as well, at a completely new property system. First time we're mentioning that in the also a bit more in public. I want to have a real property-based syntax, so no pseudo properties with foo and a set foo. But you just have a property on your object, and you can assign to it, and you can read from it. We have a prototype actually working. It's looking pretty damn good. We want to have built-in support for bindings, so you can do bindings also on the C++ side and move all of that all the way down into the core of Qt, into Qt core, make it available for all of Qt and use it everywhere. So also in widgets. Have a really easy to use C++ API, and actually it removes a lot of glue code there as well, in many cases where you'd have to connect to a change signal and then do something. Can do that much easier now. We'll support lazy binding evaluation, so the binding will only get re-evaluated when you read the property. And it will mean a significant reduction in memory allocations for QML, and it's actually a lot faster. Here's the syntax. For if you basically create your own class, you can put in properties, for example, its, int, width, height, and then you can set up bindings. So you can bind the height to the width. It's always square, the item. And you can set a border and bind that to a tenth of the width. So you have a tenth of the width is always the border. And we have tested that. We know this works. We have this implemented. And you can basically read the width and assign to the width just as you ever wanted to. We'll take care. We'll make sure the dependencies stay in sync. When you assign to the width, the bindings for height and border will get marked as dirty. And when you read height and border, the bindings will get reevaluated. We'll make sure that you get the right value out. We'll compile QML to native code. I already talked about that. And with the full type information that that we hopefully then have in the new version of QML, we can generate really efficient C++. Compile into C++ classes. QML properties will map to that Q property instance that I just showed, and QML bindings can be mapped to C++ bindings. Current Qt QML will be, we're thinking about splitting up, make it actually a relatively small runtime for compiled QML, move the object model into Qt core, lots of other things into their own libraries, especially also the JavaScript part. Over time, but well, let's see. As said, separate JavaScript, Qt QML should not depend on it, and so neither Qt Quick and others. Those should be optional. And with that, we have a slightly restricted QML that we can compile to C++, and JavaScript you will still need for certain things. If you want to include JavaScript in your project, or if you want to use items like Canvas or Worker Script and these kind of things. But with that, we can remove this. Hopefully, remove all JavaScript dependencies from Qt Quick. And then we finally, you know, to fill up the gap that Qt script getting rid of Qt script leaves, we need to extend the QJS type of APIs a little bit there. On the language changes, we'll need to remove context properties to be able to do that. You'll need to use singletons instead. Somewhat simplify the lookup and scoping rules, which means that you need to explicitly use the ID in a few more places. But then we can also remove the QML versioning, make that unnecessary, have the strongly typed support available, as I said, and compile all of that down and add hopefully private and public as qualifiers for properties and functions. Compatibility, we'll need to differentiate between current QML and the next QML, maybe with a file extension, pragma or import, we don't quite know yet. With QML2, we'll need to do things at runtime and still interpret or JIT the QML code. So this will probably stay relatively similar to what we currently have there. But we hope that they can then use still the same Qt Quick library on top of it. So with that, we're moving a lot of work from runtime to compile time. It should be a lot faster with binding evaluations. I did some initial benchmarks, and it's 10 to 100 times faster, the binding engines. So it's a really big improvement that we can get with that. The reduction in memory consumption should also be very significant. We've done some work there with, I don't know if you've seen our announcement around Qt for microcontrollers, which is basically actually just Qt Quick, a re-implementation of Qt Quick, fully from ground up to microcontrollers, using a lot of the concepts that I've actually presented here now. So we're bringing all of that work now back into Qt 6. And we can run there with half a meg of memory, a UI, a fully fledged UI. It's pretty good. So that's what we're doing on the QML side. This will be a large project and require quite a bit of work, but I'm pretty confident we can do at least most of it. We're working a lot on a new graphics architecture, and actually you might have seen some of those things already. Some of them are coming already to Qt 5, but Qt 6 is where things will fully come together. The architecture goes into looking also at the bottom that we have now more than one graphics API. OpenGL is not the only player in town anymore as it was when we released Qt 5. There's Vulkan, there's Metal, Apple has deprecated OpenGL, there's Direct3D on Windows. We want to make sure we can support all of those. And we want to make sure that Qt Quick as a 2D UI technology gets proper and easy to use 3D extensions. For the graphics independence, we've now introduced what we call the Qt rendering hardware interface. It's basically a very thin abstraction layer on top of the graphics APIs. And it's tuned towards the need of Qt itself. Currently, it's also private API in Qt, built on top of the Qt platform abstraction API, and where we support now OpenGL, Vulkan, Direct3D, and Metal. Parallel to that, we have the shader tools, which is helping us to write to create a shader package. If you write an OpenGL shader, or it wouldn't work on Direct3D, so we need to have something to cross-compile those shaders from the one language to another. And we do that with the shader tools package, which builds on top of the Sphere V ecosystem toolchain by Kronos. With that, you can create a fully cross a shader package that then works everywhere. On the higher level, as said, we want to introduce better 3D support for Qt Quick. Currently, what you have is that you have Qt Quick and some 3D, whether that's Qt 3D or the Qt 3D Studio runtime. They're side by side, independent scene graphs, independent runtimes. They're doing their own animations. You can't sync between them. And it actually has a lot of overhead, especially on low-end hardware, because one of the two needs to be rendered into an off-screen frame buffer. So bring those together, Qt Quick, and extend that with 3D capabilities. Where you have one street scene graph, and it's all based on top of QML, and where you have one animation system, one state transition system. So So it's just an extension to Qt Quick in the end. Here's an example. I'm not sure you can read that from the back, but this is how Qt Quick 3D now looks. Builds on QML, has all the language features available. As I said, you can use it with all existing Qt Quick APIs. It's just another import. It has a high-level API for 3D content. If you see here, this is an example where we have a 2D Qt Quick image element and a 3D cube in there. And you just create a window. You have the 2D image element on the top. Then we have a view 3D, which is, you know, says about the 3D view, where you have an environment, a camera, and then a model, which is just a cube with a glass material. And there's a rotation animation there that rotates that cube. It's very simple and straightforward. And even, you know, for most people who don't really know the in-depth OpenGL, it's very easy to use and read. And that's really the goal for us. For both of those technologies, we're trying to get at least part of that into Qt 5 already, 5.14 as a technology preview, and then 5.15 supporting both the rendering hardware interface and Qt Quick 3D. There's one limitation. Combining Qt Quick 3D and the rendering hardware interface will not work in Qt 5.15. You have to choose one or the other. That's Qt 6 material then. That's where we can bring everything together. And we clean out also all of the direct OpenGL dependencies we have in Qt. In Qt 5, we're currently having two graphical tools to create user interfaces with Qt Design Studio, Qt 3D Studio. Design Studio just being a Qt creator with a different user interface on top that's designer friendly. They're separate independent applications, and we want to basically bring those together and align all our graphical tooling on top of Qt Creator. So Design Studio is Qt Creator with a designer-centric user interface. And merge all the 3D design functionality that we have back into Qt Creator and Design Studio. So we have one set of tools that help both the designers, UX designers, and the developers. UX designers also have all the development functionality hidden behind the scenes. So they can go and basically, without them really seeing it, compile for an embedded device and deploy to that device, test on that device. So this is a bit of an overview over the technical work. There's a lot of other smaller things throughout Qt that we're planning on changing. Probably don't have time to go through that. I have a little bit of a final thing on, you know, the product structure and what we're doing there. And well, this will also be the one place where I mention a little bit of the commercial side of Qt. As you know, it's dual licensed, and Qt development is funded pretty much by the people who buy commercial licenses. At least that's, you know, even though we're working in the open as an open source project, Qt company is taking the 90% of the R&D costs, and we have a very large product. So all of Qt for application development is open free software. Most of Qt device creation is actually also free software, but the package thing is something that we only have available commercially. So somehow we need to find ways to balance things so that we can grow the business to be able to fund our future development, as well as growing the ecosystem by having the free open source version available there. From that perspective, you know, the current licensing is not 100% ideal. Ideally would be something where we have a bit more GPL content on the add-on side, keep the essentials LGPL, and then maybe some commercial licensing for integrations with commercial stuff where open source makes a lot less sense. We'll see how this develops and what we do there. This is also something which we're talking currently with the KDE Free Qt Foundation about. Let's see where this leads us. Still a very much of an open discussion. But one thing we want to do is with Qt 6 is we want to go for a little bit of a smaller set of core libraries in the product. Have the core product, the Qt packages that you download, a little bit slimmer, mostly the essentials and the tooling. Just to also simplify our work on getting releases out and deliver add-ons a little bit separately. There's also a need for that, for example, very strongly in the web with Web Engine, which would actually need an update schedule that's much, much more frequent than what we can do with Qt. For Chromium is updating every 6 weeks. We have releases every half a year. And then there's the LTS releases, which would need for security updates also a newer Chromium version. So decoupling those release schedules would be actually make things much easier in that respect. And the way we want to do that is by introducing also a marketplace as a central rallying point for the Qt ecosystem. And there we want to give everybody the opportunity and the place to publish their own additions to Qt. And that's, of course, also something that's an opportunity for you here to think about whether you want to do that, want to have space for both free and paid content and make it easy to discover additional functionality to Qt. And it also comes from the realization that we can't put everything into Qt itself. There's things that are around there in the ecosystem, and we're seeing that others have been, you know, introducing those kind of marketplaces and getting a lot of really good feedback there. So the idea is that the content on that marketplace is mainly focusing around extensions to Qt, to the tools, to the frameworks, content that integrates with Qt, maybe graphical assets, a new style for Qt widgets, Qt quick controls, imagery, maybe, you know, in the longer term, AI models that you can just use and plug in to do image recognition, something like that. I don't know what it will be, but I hope we'll get a lot of good and interesting things there. And then we thought about delivering some of our add-ons just simply the same way through the marketplace, and by that decoupling the release schedules. So this is a little bit to the side of Qt 6. It's work that's already happening now a bit in the Qt company. We hope to have something out there by, let's say, World Summit approximately, at least as a first proof of concept, initial version, minimum viable product, something like that. So lots of things happening. I think I went a little bit over time. I hope that's fine, and you'll forgive me for that one. Thank you very much for listening.